Warning. The following podcast contains two morons talking about sophisticated subject matter, like ninus and hoo-has. Also a few whoopsie-daisies and at least one Hauser ante. If you don't have a strong stomach, you know where the door is. Right. On with the shenanigans, then.
The podcast which you are about to hear is an account of the tragedy which befell two washed-up losers. In particular, Court PSYOPS and his immature co-host, Matt. It was all the more tragic in that they were uncultured morons. But had they lived very, very full lives, they could not have expected, nor would they have wished to see, as much of the mad and macabre as they were to see each week. For them, an idiotic podcast show became a nightmare. The events of each week were to lead to the discovery of one of the most bizarre crimes in the annals of American history, Cinema PSYOPS, with Court and Matt.
What is PSYOPS?
PSYOPS for psychological operations is very simply the art of influencing how people feel and think and ultimately how they behave and what they do. You don't have to defeat the enemy on the battlefield. It's better if you can convince the enemy to do what you want him to do without having to fight him. And that's really the intent behind PSYOPS, to convince people to do what you want them to do.
So how does PSYOPS fit into what's happening now?
The two points I'd like to make with you and the audience is that, first and foremost, PSYOPS saves lives. The second thing I'd like to say, a lot of people have misconception about PSYOPS. They think it's something devious and brainwashing.
You don't know exactly what's going on right now, but we do know that there are some PSYOPS going on, right?
Ma'am, I don't know.
Cinema PSYOPS.
And I believe with all of my heart that it is a contributing factor to our juvenile delinquency of today. Why I believe that is because I know how it feels. I know what it does to you.
Cinema PSYOPS.
They think it's something devious and brainwashing.
The 299th consecutive week of Cinema PSYOPS. That is 299 weeks where Matt and myself, Matt, my co-host, myself, Court, your main host, have gotten together to record a review about at least one movie, sometimes three, sometimes two, occasionally a TV series that's related to a movie just because it's in the same fucking franchise. We've done this for 299 consecutive weeks. And joining me live via Skype to celebrate this momentous occasion of us just doing the same goddamn thing every week and pretending it's special is my co-host, Matt.
Hi, I'm here. 299 weeks. We had old doing this shit.
299 weeks solid that we have done recordings and releases.
That's fucking insane.
Yeah, there has been a brand new, just recorded previously, maybe 2 weeks in advance at the most, episodes of Cinema PSYOPS every week for our listeners. We've done that. 299.
Even through pandemics.
Yeah.
And us catching said pandemics, or at least me.
And one of us being in a household with someone who caught it and somehow didn't catch it. And then when he got the second dose of the vaccine, had his ass fucking handed to him by it.
Oh, did it go poorly for you, the second dose?
It was not fun for me, Matt.
Oof.
It was not fun in the least, no.
I mean, could always be worse. Not really.
Well, yeah, I just, that's the part that I don't really fully understand is because I was in the house with my wife when she had it. She had it for long enough to where I should have been more than exposed. I mean, as we talked about before, I do open mouth kiss my wife, so.
You do. I mean, you quite enjoy it, so as, I mean, as you should.
The only thing that I can really think that caused that is that the dose of the vaccine being introduced in that manner is when the antibodies are gone and you have to rely on your T cells, right?
Yeah.
So if that's the case and it's a straight up vaccine, I mean, while the vaccine is the weakened virus, it's still a very concentrated form to trigger such a response. And my immune system, boy, did it respond, Matt.
It got there, man. It'll get there on you.
Yeah.
My first shot was nothing. My arm was sore for a couple days. That was it. I don't know if the second shot so far for my son and my wife has gone just fine. I have mine tomorrow, so we'll see.
Yeah, Jesus wept. I was not expecting it. It fucking kicked the shit out of me. I had a really long dark night of the soul that Tuesday night right after I got it.
I heard it seems like a lot of people who didn't get COVID got their asses really well handed to them by the second shot. And then a lot of people who had COVID almost, it was minor anything they had. So who knows? That's what I'm hearing or seeing at least. Like, I had people at work who never got COVID, and yeah, the second shot, they were gone like for 2 days out of work because of it. So, you know, what the hell?
Well,
I'd rather take the 24 hours of pain of the second shot than deal with COVID the way I had to deal with it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's totally true. I agree with you there. It's such a weird thing that I have no idea how I didn't catch it the first roundabout with her.
That's an amazing thing. That's just, you know. Yeah,
that's kind of further proof. I mean, I tested negative, but I thought like maybe I had it just, you know, I fought it off. But
yeah,
the vaccine proves that wasn't the case. Somehow I didn't catch it with a person who had it in my own home.
Yeah. It's like one of those things when you hear like a tornado tears through a house, yet you find like a basket of eggs that are not broken. And you're like, no one knows how it happens. It just does.
Right. And I had some downright raunchy sex the weekend that she lost her sense of taste with my wife.
Straight up porno sex.
The kind of sex that my wife and I have, Matt, is the kind of sex that would make our listeners not believe it, that it's that fucking good. Like, I'm not humble bragging here. I'm just literally saying, like, whatever you think the ridiculous amount of great sex is that I could possibly have with someone that I've been married to for coming up on 8 years, but I've been with for over half of my life now. If you don't think that that's possible, I will tell you this, it absolutely is. And I somehow didn't catch COVID from that very athletic, deeply pornographic lovemaking session.
And you see,
my wife.
I'm pretty sure that's how I did catch COVID.
Was having sex with your wife?
Amazing, athletic, really good fucking sex with my wife. Yeah, I'm pretty sure. I'm pretty almost goddamn sure that's exactly how I caught it.
Which I should have caught it that way. You know, bodily fluids were definitely exchanged if you catch my drift.
I will say this. I don't suggest catching COVID, but if you're going to, catch it while having sex. At least you're doing something fun while you're getting it.
And in Matt's case, preferably while drunk.
I mean, last time we did that, man, that was like 17 years ago. Now I have a son, so.
Because you forgot about fancy birth control methods like pulling out.
Exactly. Yeah, I mean, very true.
All right. I just want to get a little show housekeeping out of the way. Next week is 300 episodes. And I am just going to ask it here on the show, and we'll see how much our listeners actually fucking like love us enough. Yeah. Record an MP3, record an M4A, record a little audio file of some sort on your phone. It's real easy to do. On Apple's iPhones, there's like a little memo or a voice memo app that you can use that you can just record something super quick and send it. There's got to be something like that on the Android or in the Android store, like a voice memo app that you can do. You can just record something quick.
Sure.
Just say hi, congratulate us on 300 episodes and for being here for you for 300 fucking weeks in a row.
Yeah.
And, you know, then you'll be really, really happy to know that your voice was on us covering the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, because that is our first full franchise fest. That's another thing that I wanted to get out. Duh.
Oh, yes, of course. Well, it's 300. Of course it was going to be.
Well, I was kind of considering doing the Romero movies at 300 instead of where we ended up doing it, which was last year, closing out last year.
Yeah. But
then I thought about it and I'm like, I don't want to wait that long. And then I had an argument with myself on whether or not we were going to cover literally every Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie or not.
I mean, that's a lot.
Right. It's like an excessive amount of movies. Like, there's like six more probably than there need to be at least at this point.
I mean, there's a lot of Texas Chainsaw movies from just the originals to the new wave to holy shit.
Well, they've rebooted it four fucking times. They've rebooted it four fucking times already.
Well, the latest new wave, then they came out with prequels of that new wave.
That's not the latest new wave, my dude. There are two more reboots that they tried of it after that.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, we're going to cover them. It's on the list. Now, I had been talking about doing double full franchise fest. The reason for that is, as many movies as there actually are, we don't close out this year for like several fucking weeks. Like, they're in the double digits number of weeks that we got left before the fiscal year of Cinema PsyOps ends.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I'm pulling up the schedule document right now, and I was trying to do, you know, just general pablum. There's going to be 12 total episodes this time around in the double full franchise fest back to back.
Jesus Christ.
Seven of those, technically eight, are the Texas Chainsaw Massacre franchise, because we're going to do all of those.
Yeah.
And then after that, Matt, the thing that I'm really excited about, but still didn't want to make it the 300 episode because I want to do this comparison thing that I want to have set up. All right.
Uh-huh.
The full franchise fest double header that we're doing is actually to show you how a franchise can get worse every time they come back to it and try to improve on it, with Texas Chainsaw Massacre, as I will submit to you, and how a franchise can actually improve and bring you depth of character and story and flesh out a whole entire worldview with the Phantasm series that we're going to do as well. So we're doing
Phantasm series.
Yeah.
Oh.
We're doing Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and then after that series is over, we will then reward ourselves with five episodes on the Phantasm series, which will be an ultimate palate cleanser, because the truth be told, Matt, I like maybe three of the total Texas Chainsaw Massacre movies of the franchise, and they're all at the start. So it's going to be a rough one for me.
How many episodes will Texas Chainsaw Massacre be?
It goes from episode 300 to 307, so I'm assuming by zero logic math, that would be eight.
Eight. Holy shit. That's a lot of Texas Chainsaw Massacre starting next week. But I mean, that's a lot.
It feels like it's going to be a lot.
And it feels like after like maybe two, things are going to be poor at best. I did the math.
Eight fucking Texas Chainsaw Massacre movies. Three of which I can promise are at least going to be good reviews from me. The others, I don't know what's going to happen. We'll try. We'll see what I do. This is going to be a real test of merit for me, because I always try to take the stance of talk about what you don't like about it, but don't denigrate it and just go right to fuck this movie. You have to go several steps along the way as to where it gets to fuck this movie.
Yeah.
Except for the Fog remake. Fuck that movie.
Fuck the remake. Fuck him.
Of the Fog. So that's our full franchise fest that we have planned coming up. We're going to be doing Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the eight films in that entirety of that franchise, remakes and all that shit included, showing you how a franchise can continue to dwindle, even though the budgets increase nearly every time. The franchise continues to go downhill in Texas Chainsaw Massacre, whereas the Phantasm series, the budgets diminish, Matt, except for maybe two. Two was like a jump. That was a spike where it got studio time, and then Don Coscarelli said fuck this and went back to just making them the way he wanted to make them with three and on. And I would submit to you that they get better with story and character and all of that other kind of stuff. So I feel like we're going to kind of line up on this opinion-wise with a lot of those movies, but it would be kind of funny if we didn't.
Yeah, right?
And I know you've seen at least Phantasm 2 before.
Yes. I believe I don't remember it, though, so because it's been a long time.
Yeah, so this is going to be a really interesting series for, like,
the Phantasm series I'm really excited about, because I'd probably seen almost all the Texas Chainsaw Massacre movies we're getting ready to watch in some form or another. So
many of them
the Phantasm series, I don't remember at all. So I'm really excited to watch that one.
Well, that is totally interesting. And then this will really prove the hypothesis, because you know what you're expecting with the Texas Chainsaw Massacre movies, and you aren't arguing with me that it does get worse with every
sequel. I'm not. It gets worse as we go on. I'm completely in agreement with you. As I've seen, like I said, I've seen a lot of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre movies. I've watched them, and it's not the greatest.
So the only real hypothesis that I need to prove in this, then, is that the Phantasm movies are an example of the money gets less, yet the creativity gets more, and the franchise becomes better as it moves along.
And that will be a surprise for me. I'll only be able to comment on that when I actually watch them.
Yeah, that's what we're going to be doing now. What I didn't intend to have happen, and what we ended up kind of doing, is a head-to-head or a back-to-back of the Lady Snowblood films, and then the Ochô series is what I believe they're referred to as. And tonight we are talking female
Female Yakuza tale.
colon, Inquisition and torture.
Yeah.
Why are they inquisitioning and torturing a colon, Matt?
Well, you know, it's just the most bullshit thing on the whole entire fucking spectrum of sentences. So
some would argue Oxford comma would be worse, and that's why they tried to get rid of it. But I back the Oxford comma, and I stand firmly beside it.
Yeah, I do too, actually. I believe it's gotten a bad rap in a lot of years, and everyone go fuck themselves if they don't like it.
Yeah, the Oxford comma is an essential thing.
Yeah,
as far as I agree. And colons just give you cancer.
Yeah, yeah, colons just, I mean, they'll make process your poops, but
this'll keep you quiet. Oh, hi there. I didn't see you. You caught me cutting a new show. I'm Bo Ransdell, and I'm one of the many creators you can find on Legion Podcasts. I said quiet! My fellow podcasters and I work hard to bring you the best in horror podcasting, but that comes at a cost.
Wouldst thou like to live deliciously?
Not that, but also, yes. No, what I'm getting at is that there are server costs, costs for good microphones and software for editing, all the things that make our shows, you know, fun to listen to. And you can help. If you're enjoying the shows on legionpodcasts.com, or in the Legion Network available on iTunes and Stitcher, just about anywhere you can download a podcast, really, you can help us out and get a little something for your trouble at patreon.com/legionpodcasts. For just $2 a month, you get a pair of movie commentaries exclusive to Patreon, and for $5, you can also join us for a monthly screening of a movie. All of that available on patreon.com/legionpodcasts. We appreciate it, and thank you for listening. Now, back to the cutting room.
That fucking soundtrack will kick your fucking ass.
That sounded good. That sounded fresh.
I think the main reason why both of us dug the soundtrack, as I'm clearly speaking for both of us, even though I didn't get your opinion on it just yet, is,
I mean, it was a safe bet because I also enjoyed it.
Yeah, I think it has a lot to do with the types of like Bond films and stuff that you and I may have been raised on as kids. It reminded us of that. It has that like
definitely
very swinging like late 60s kick-ass sound to it, or at least a lot of these spy action movies would have.
You know what it kind of reminds me of too is the very first movie of Austin Powers had a lot of that stuff in it.
Right, which is what I'm making a reference to. I knew that would be the reason.
I mean,
that
just
like
the more, maybe it's more fresh in my mind thinking about Austin Powers than when I was a kid. But yeah, it's same damn thing. And yeah, that's probably why we're so into it.
That's got to be it. The rest of the film doesn't quite fit the soundtrack in this one because they're still at that Maija, like the end of that period. But there's more and more like hip, cool cats roaming around, not wearing traditional garb. There's a lot of suits in this. There's a lot of like business suits that people are wearing. So it's a real turn of the century thing going on with this movie. So I think they were just kind of pushing it forward. And also this was the hip music at the time. And as most sequels are mostly focused on just making more money off the same characters, that's probably what they're doing.
doing.
True.
Grab as many people with the more modern hip music as you possibly can in your movie. Let's do the review.
All right. Female Yakuza tale. Here we go. We start with Ochô being surrounded by some assholes, and she says, "You got the wrong guy, wrong lady," and then she strips naked and kills all those motherfuckers. So we start off with a bang. So, all right, then yes, we go to the docks, and Ochô meets with a young woman who takes her. Says, you know, I'm here to meet with you. And Ochô says, okay. She takes her to meet some men. Well, they chloroform her and then string her up. And they strip her naked and they, to put it gently, feel inside of her.
They are looking specifically for something that they're expecting to be hidden in her vagina. But they are really doing it in a very rapey way where they keep
going. Very rapey. I mean, they molested her breasts. I mean, they raped. They or at least sexually assaulted.
It's digital. It's digital penetration, and it is sexual assault. Yes.
Yes. Yes. So it is fucking terrible. Well, they find that there's a problem. There's nothing in there, or they don't say that. They just say there's a problem. So. They said, well, okay, let's just dump the problem. So they do. They dump everything. Or they dump her off. And she's lying there. And another man wakes her up. And she wakes up and she's holding the sword. And she's right next to another dead woman. The man states that he found her like this after following a gang that he's been looking. They're setting her up to take the fall for what he calls the crotch murderers or crotch grouger murders.
Crotch gouge murderer.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah,
that. And they're setting her up and they'll testify that she did it and she's being found like this. So he says he's going to take them down and that he thinks she can help him. Well, then he decides to leave. As he leaves, a bunch of armed men start following him, chase after him, and shoot him. They only hit him in the arm, but he's able to evade them. And then, as he's kind of hiding out, he runs into this woman named Yoshomi of Christ. And she says when she prays, she kills. So, you know, damn.
there was some promo that I had seen. The sequence where she first introduces herself in that sort of like somewhat nun outfit that's clearly not a nun outfit. And she walks down the alleyway and then she stops and it's like her face is like the bulk of the frame in the center just off to the side and she turns her head in that alleyway. That was in some kind of a promo for something at Alamo Drafthouse like all the time. And that image popped into my head where I was like, holy fuck. So that's where this came from.
Yeah, right. She leads him away because she's like, hey, I want to help you. And they evade the men. She already looks like she's kind of like a nun or something. Not really a nun, but she's dressed in black and white. And he steals a priest's outfit. And they're able to escape. And as they're hiding out in this little hideaway, they're getting changed into wet clothes. And he starts making the moves on her because apparently he hasn't had sex with anybody in 5 years. And she's like, no, that's not going to happen. And then she fucks him up and then takes out a hidden sword from her hair. Says it, and he says, well, message received. And then he says also something about her not being a woman.
To him, he cannot look at her as an object that he can own. To him, that's what a woman is.
Oh, wow. That does not make this guy all that great.
I'm thinking it's just a bad translation and I'm just reading into it because every man in this fucking show is terrible. But this character has been in prison for 5 years, so he's just trying to get with anyone.
Yeah.
To quote Matthew Perry in The Whole Nine Yards, he'd sleep with a meat grinder. but like, I think that's just kind of the point that they were trying to get across. But I think what he was getting at was, you're not a woman to me, as in you are not an object of desire. I will not do this again. Like he gets it, you know, like you won't register that way for me or whatever it is. Like, that's kind of what he was saying. And judging by this character's behavior later in the movie, what I was saying was just basically a bunch of horse shit because I'm angry at men in this movie.
I mean, why wouldn't you be?
Right. They're fucking terrible. But like, this guy, not that he is what I would call a good man, I would say that by proxy, he is the least rotten of an asshole to women.
Yeah. All right.
And somewhat respectful because he does end up being interacting with a lot of these ladies and treating them at least somewhat like human beings comparably.
Yeah. So, I mean, you're not wrong. So then we cut to a newspaper discussing about the crotch gouging killer and that maybe it's a woman and the woman's being seen. So, shit. You know, they're already trying to blame her. So So then we see Ochô is searching for some clues, and she catches a particular pickpocket. She has the girl take her to the boss of the pickpockets. So she goes to HQ, and Ochô watches some peeps having some sex, and she's really jealous of that because she says she's single, and she's kind of pissed about it.
This is so, kind of the first expression we've seen this character make of her own desire.
Yeah, I think so.
You notice there's also a detachment of what happened to her earlier, and then her still having desire or expressing desire and, like, really enjoying watching sex. Although it could be stated that after the sexual assault, she may be responding in such a manner as to gain control back over her own body, like subconsciously. Sometimes we do that, true. You know, whenever a human being is a victim of assault like that, they behave in such a manner as to gain autonomy over their own body and control of their sex and their desire.
Yeah, so, exactly.
I mean, that could have something to do with it, but I think it was more in the filmmaker's aspect of it. I think it was more attempting to somewhat humanize Ochô and show that, you know, she
has feelings.
Yeah, she's beyond the vengeance. She's actually living her life, and now she's expressing a bit of a regret that maybe she can't find love. And by love, I mean physical sex.
Yeah. So the boss then will see her, and Ochô says she wants to buy out one of her hand ladies. Well, the boss doesn't like that. She says it's no go, and then a whole bunch of women show up, and they want to fight. And Ochô does a pretty good job of kicking all their asses. She then lights her little basement area on fire and grabs one of the girls, and the girl that she grabs just happens to be the girl that found her and took her to those men. And that ends the first 20 minutes.
Okay, we need to talk about the very intro of the film, because we kind of neglected it to get into the story, but the intro where the men are asking who she is, then we see her kicking the living shit out of all of them.
Yeah, all naked, by the way.
Well, topless. So thank you, movie, topless. For that, definitely.
Thank you. I mean, holy shit, thank you, movie.
Yeah,
that was his slow-mo, too. That was some exciting stuff.
Visually speaking, the motions of her swiping at them with swords is quite beautifully shot and is very innovative stuff, that what they're kind of doing here and the slow-mo techniques that they're using and the way that they're cutting it. This is one of those, like, Hepcat cool flicks, man. Like, dig the slow motion of those boobs shaking as she slices through these dudes. It's definitely some cool ass shit. All right. We need to discuss that. Definitely.
Yes. Agree.
Now, the choreography in this movie, and I don't know if you noticed it or not as good as the last film. Like, it's definitely lacking in a lot of the stuff in the action. And there's several spots where we have seen Reiko Ike actually do some amazing swordplay and footwork in this film, or at least they shot someone that did in the other film.
Except for unfortunately the very beginning and what will be the very end, she doesn't really get to do a lot of sword play.
Yeah, there's not really a lot of that. And this is more of an intrigue.
With all the thief women, this fight, very sloppy. You can tell, just kind of just not a lot of fluid movement. So it's almost like they couldn't really afford a lot of good stunt doubles. And it was just kind of like, all right, kind of just roam around and do things and make it look good.
They don't necessarily need stunt doubles to pull off sword play. What they need is actors who can work with choreography or like even just dance moves, because that's all the sword play really is. It's the water dance, you know?
Yeah, it's true.
So what they could have done with, and they didn't not have money because they burnt like part of a set down for that fight. But it seems like that whoever shot this wasn't interested in doing choreography and wanted it to be more realistic and trusted in his actors and his actress. But at the same time, the actors look like they're looking off camera during the fights to what do I do next? You know, it just like there's a couple sequences where I think I may have seen an actor or an actress in the background do that right before they approach Ochô with the sword.
Yeah. Sometimes it seems like they're reading too. Like maybe they couldn't really remember their lines all that well.
That I don't know so much, but I know there's a couple sequences where I see the person look off camera, like to where a director might possibly be. Like an extra just totally loses focus in the middle of a fight and looks up. I noticed that. But like, basically what I'm getting at here is it looks like the actors and the actresses, whenever they're doing the fighting, are somewhat winging it, but are being shouted directions of things to do. But like, they don't know when to move. So everything's really stiff. It's not very fluid. And the last movie, the choreography in that very much was like a ballet with swords and bloodshed. And yes, a woman murdering dudes naked.
Yeah, which is just fine by me.
Right. And
we could have all movies like that.
This film is definitely more of a straight up like bad girl gang kind of movie than it is like swordplay. So when it's called Female Yakuza Tale, what it truly is like the first all female Yakuza getting set up or something like that is the story that they're telling. And so that doesn't involve swordplay, although swordplay and that sort of thing is going on. This is more of like a straight up Yakuza gangster film. So you don't realize that at first, but like it very quickly develops into that. And there's a certain point in the film where you either get into that or you just completely abandon all hope and you're not going to enjoy yourself. And
yeah, exactly.
Depending upon your response, if you can shift the gear from what you were kind of hoping you were going to get and then what you end up getting, then you know you're probably going to enjoy it, because the film does go way full off into the Pinku Iga stuff that I've seen before, crazy levels of shit. Like,
yeah, that's not wrong.
Yeah, and it does have a finale that it really pushes hard for.
Oh, it really does.
But like all of the time working up to that is totally a Yakuza gangster film. And be prepared for that when you're going to watch this.
That, all right. Yeah. I mean, I've never seen I'm not experienced with these kind of films, but yeah, if this is what they're usually like, holy shit.
We'll probably be skirting away from some Japanese cinema because honestly, dude, I don't know if you can handle some of it.
Oh yeah, probably not. I mean...
There were certain things that I discussed with you that I'm like, yeah, I'm not going to make you watch this in a film. And I think the Japanese films, like, knowingly, I'm not going to make you watch this stuff. And some of the Japanese films that we were going to cover, I read a little bit about them. I'm like, no, Matt will quit the show. So,
that bad, huh?
Jesus. Yeah, they fucking make some intense stuff, man. They really do.
Good God almighty. Woo, all right, well, we start the next 20 minutes. Like I said, the girl she's the one who met her off the boat at the dock. She interrogates her, and she finds out that she tells the story how she tried to rob one of those three men, and she was caught, and then pretty much gang raped and photographed while being gang raped. And you get to see all this starting to happen.
As she tells the tale, you witness it on screen, and I was saying it's rough, and boy, howdy is it.
It is not fucking easy to watch. No, it is. It's pretty fucking rough, yeah.
And so, let's just be frank, the way that this is shot, they are trying to sell it as sexy and hot when it's fucking definitely gross and disgusting.
It's fucking gross. They are trying to sell it as hot, though. You're damn right.
And it's fucking vile.
Well, then they tell her to bring other girls, and so she does. She brings all the girls from her thief house, and they get them all addicted to drugs. Then we see them betting on what size of dildos they can shove up the girls, which is fucking gross, and they have gotten all the girls addicted to drugs so that they don't fight them off anymore, and it's all just fucking horrible.
Yeah, it gets really fucking intense, and I was like, man, is he going to tap out on this, or are we going to do this movie? Because there were some parts where I'm like, Jesus Christ.
This is about where I was going to tap out. I made it through this and then never got as terrible again, but I mean, not that it wasn't terrible in some parts, but not this bad. But yeah, when they were practicing with the dildos, that's what I almost was like, yeah, we'll see you later.
And they weren't even like dildos. It was like a hole stretching thing, these various devices. Like, it looked like they were literally just trying to see if they could tear something. So you know that they're the crotch gouging gang. They do this and see if the girls can take it or if they'll survive. And then if their bodies don't allow something like that to happen and they tear or they injure them really bad.
They're probably no good for drug running.
Or whatever. And then they just dump them somewhere to bleed to death after being destroyed in such a manner.
Yep.
I mean, I was watching this and I'm not ashamed to admit it. This shit was too much for me. Like, I was like, this is too goddamn much. It wasn't
fucking rough.
Yeah, this wasn't, I was like, Jesus, I hope the whole movie's not going to be like this. And I tend to watch them before you do, because I watch them earlier in the night than what you do. So when I was going through this part, I was like, Jesus, I don't know if Matt's going to make it through. And I realized that, like, I got to get to a certain point in the movie to see if this is going to get this bad again. And and like right about the point where Ochô starts actually interacting with these guys, it doesn't really get this bad again, although it does get pretty intense in certain moments. And I was like, yeah, I think he'll be okay. I think if he makes it through that part, I think he'll be okay. And hearing you say that, and that's exactly what happened, I'm like, cool. I know my co-host enough to know what he can take.
That's exactly right. Well, all right. So then we see this girl is strung out on drugs, and she's begging for a hit. So he, you know, Ochô wants more information. She says she takes women who wear red sashes from the harbor to the guys, and then they give her drugs when she delivers the women. So Ochô then, she finds out what hotel they're staying at. So she goes, stakes out the hotel, and she sees the man from earlier who helped her leaving. She follows him, and when they come to this field of, like, flowers, she sees he's gone. Well, he pops up because he notices she was following him. Well, they talk, and she thinks he works for the gang, but he says he was just following up on a lead, and he checked the hotel, and those men are gone. So anyway, we find out his name is Jyoji, and he starts following her, and when she's asked why, he says, well, we're probably going to the same place. Well, she enters this shop, and she wants to see the boss, and then it turns out the guy gets in there, and turns out that this is their brother, who they haven't seen for 5 years. So Jyoji talks first with the new boss. He says that he knows that he's trying to kill him, and he's mad that he let the old boss's daughter run away, and they never looked for her. And he said, the next time we see each other, I'm going to kill you. Then things get a little tense. He grabs a gun out of new boss's pocket, empties it. The bullets are on the ground. He swipes them. One impales into a guy's eye. It's fucking crazy.
Yeah. This is where the movie started winning me back, because the shit that they were showing earlier, I was like, I do not want to watch that.
But I mean, that was pretty fucking cool when he slapped the bullets. And then as he's walking out, he shoots off half a guy's mustache. That's just fucking epic.
Basically, this guy is a Yakuza. He went away for 5 years, and it's the fault of the guys that are now in charge of this particular Yakuza clan. I think it's the Ogi is what they say, clan. Now, Ojai, whatever the guy's name is, which sounds exactly the same as the clan name to me, but just spelled differently. He is what I would assume the old guard badass that only does what he has to do when he has to do it. Like, he feels to me like he was sort of the enforcer of the original boss, and he got set up so they could get the original boss out of the way.
Yes. And, I mean, he obviously is, a part of the rate, you know, he's loyal to the old boss. So, obviously set up, sent to prison. He said he never agreed with new boss getting in power. And he said the new boss begged him to take over the docks. And when he did, that's when he went down for the drug bust of getting arrested. So it feels like he was set up. Yeah, definitely for those 5 years.
Okay. Now he's out, and he is essentially saying, I know you did it. You're fucking done. It's a matter of time. He does say, the next time I see you, I'm going to kill you. And then that's when the guys start getting all tough, where they're like, well, if that's the case, we're just going to take care of it here. And that's when he grabs the boss's gun. Does the shit with the bullets to take them out and just put them in their place. Because he's like, I did that with my hand, just tossing bullets slightly at you.
Yeah.
Imagine what I can do if the gun actually is loaded. So then he loads it, and he shows that to them by purposely shooting off the guy's mustache just as a display of fucking force of what he is capable of.
Of what he can do.
Yeah. I mean, it is corny. I will fully admit that.
Corny, but I fucking love it.
Yeah.
I just loved it. I thought that was fucking awesome.
Yeah.
That was a great scene.
That's the thing. It's like, okay, so that's the kind of movie we're going to be doing. That's the kind of party we're going to be involved with. I'll put my dick in the mashed potatoes and let's go, because that's fucking awesome. Let's go.
Yeah, man. It's great.
And that's why I said it won me over, because I was having a good time and I was laughing at this stuff. And I'm like, if you're going to do comic relief where he humiliates these guys with like trick shot techniques and stuff, I'm down, movie. I can do this.
That's fucking do it, man. That's what I'm here for.
Plus, I've never seen it in a movie before in my entire life. Somebody shoot a dude's mustache off.
How about this? I've never seen a guy not throw a bullet, backhand a bullet into another guy's eyeball.
Right. I've never seen that before in my life. And that won me back over, and I figured that's what would happen for you too.
Pretty much. I was fucking into that. That was just the best.
So this movie's gonna play with your emotions like that for the rest of it, Matt, but it keeps rewarding you every time it punishes you, just like a good S&M flick should.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, it giveth and then it taketh away.
It spanks you and then it rubs on the salve.
Well, now it's Ocho's turn to see the boss, and she has to pay tribute to the old boss. And then we get a flashback where we see a very young Ochô playing that card game she likes. And what happened was she was cheating another mob boss named Tiger. And when Tiger was getting ready to kill her, the old boss showed up and said, you know, she's so young, I'll take it. And he goes, you can take one of my fingers. And Tiger was like, nah, man. He goes, I want more than just one finger. He goes, all right, well, let's go. And he cuts off one finger, and the old boss doesn't make a fucking sound. takes it like a goddamn, just like a boss.
Just like an old boss.
Like an old G boss. And this makes Tiger severely uncomfortable because he's like, he's not making any noises. So he says, I've had enough. And then old boss goes, I'm sorry, everyone, I caused a scene, if you'll excuse me. And he and Ochô leave. And he tells Ochô if putting her on the straight and narrow, because she has her whole life ahead of her, only cost him one finger, it was worth it to him. So Ochô obviously has very strong positive feelings for this old boss.
Well, this particular boss is the kind of old guard, honorable.
Yeah.
Even though he's a thief, he does the right thing. And he saw that he could save someone, and he does. So, like, this is very honorable shit that he's doing here.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So with everything kind of going on, the new boss talks to Ochô and says, hey, listen, I owe a shit ton of money to Tiger, and he needs to get paid. And she goes, so you want me to play the game and cheat? And he goes, yeah, because if you don't, I'm going to lose all my territory. And that will, you know, do a disservice to the old boss's memory. And that ends that 20 minutes.
So
now we got multiple things happening here, which is something I kind of like. I kind of like that feeling of, you know, when you got a lot of shit going on in a movie.
Yeah, I kind of mentioned or alluded to and made a joke about how this was like a James Bond film, but it really is. Yeah, she's
it really is.
She's infiltrating this and just kind of seeing. She came to this place to pay respects to the boss when she didn't realize, I guess, that he was dead, or maybe she did find out that he was dead, maybe heard that this is the new boss, and so that's why she was there. The other guy was there to kick ass and take names, and she watches the entire time that he does it, and I'm not sure about you, Matt, but that little smile that she gets when he's kicking ass and taking names sure looked to me like she was getting a wide on.
Oh, yeah, she definitely was. She was into it. Yeah, yeah, she was pretty happy watching that guy go.
She liked him because he was every bit as deadly as what she is, basically.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. So she was definitely into that guy. We see there's a lot of relationships here that are intertwined. So, yeah, it always makes for a really interesting movie.
Yeah, they're setting up an entire timeline and a history of all of these people to where all of this has been coming to a head for a while. But what we need to keep in mind is it's not just, like, hinted at. Our main character dude here that just kicked all of that ass just basically accuses them of murdering the old boss and then getting him out of the way after it happened.
Yeah, and doing something to the daughter.
Right, and they disappeared the daughter in some way, shape, or form, and he's going to find out what and how. Like, he just flat out says all of that. So we already know that there is no honor among any of those guys that are underneath this new boss, because they're all okay with it.
Yep.
We know that the new boss is working with those guys, because aren't they there? Don't we see them there at this, like, Yakuza
those
shrine
three,
at that time?
Those three middlemen? Not yet.
Not yet, okay. Okay.
Not yet.
All right. So
we don't know that new boss is working with the three middlemen yet, but we're about to find out.
Okay. Yeah. I'm confusing the timeline of when this happens. But so basically he goes to talk to that guy and we're like, Jesus, what's the problem? And so far the new boss is like, yeah, look, I'm a big fuck up. I owe a bunch of money. So, you know, he's a huge fuck up.
Yeah. You know, he's a huge fuck up. A mob boss who owns another mob boss a shit ton of money. That's not a good mob boss. Usually a mob boss, a good one, does it either get high on their own product. It doesn't lose money to his own bookies.
Well, and the worst part of it is it sounds like he owes so much that he's literally losing all of the territory for this clan.
Yeah, he is.
That is a monumental fuck up of epic proportions, dude.
Pretty much. Yeah, this guy's not very good. He never should be a boss, but he's just power hungry enough to want it.
It's almost like he's got this really bad spray tan and a really, really cheap suit.
God, it's almost like he might want to dye his hair blonde.
Or like get a lot of hair plugs so he has a massive comb over coming up from like one ear all the way over to go around the other one.
Yeah, that too. What a piece of shit.
Yeah, this guy's like a monumental fuck up, basically.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Pretty much. You are not wrong. So we start the next 20 minutes with Ochô follows one of the ladies who are going to get ladies from the dock. And they're pulling them off with the red scarves. And she follows them to the hideout. We have scenes of, you know, the guys have the girls stripped. They take the drugs out of them. Then they put drugs in them and then give them shots in their tits for the fix for the drugs that is kind of their payment. The girls leave, and we see Yoshimi and Yoji are watching. They see Ochô following some of the girls, and so they follow as well. Ochô stops some of the ladies and tell them what is inside of them is not real drugs. She already noticed that it was fake. All the shit that was in the vials that was put up inside of them was fake.
Yeah, the girls are bringing in the drugs from China or wherever that's coming in from the mob boss.
Yeah.
Which we don't know who it's coming in from yet, did they say?
So yeah, so what happens is they take the real drugs out,
and then
it's almost like these middlemen intercept them. They take the real drugs out, put fake drugs in.
But they shouldn't be doing that at all, is the point.
No, no, not at all. So then, Yoji shows up and tells all the girls that they've met their match with Ochô. Then we see Yoshimi, she calls out to all these other women. They all start showing up, and it shows they all have red scarves on as well, but they weren't taken in by the middlemen. They were in a gang with Yoshimi until Yoshimi went to jail. Then these ladies did start for a time running drugs for those guys. Yoshimi mentions how the guys killed two of her friends, and she will have her vengeance on them. So she has her issues with the middlemen. So the middlemen, those three middlemen who kind of did a lot of horrible shit.
It's hinted at that the person who is her friend that died is the one that Ochô was set up for, and that's why she was following Ochô.
Yes, it could be possible. That is right.
Yeah.
All the thieves get together, all the thief women, and Yoshimi's group all of women get together, and Ocho's there. They all forgive the one girl for getting them all hooked on smack and getting them involved in this. And then while they're all topless, they all take the oath of thieves, I guess.
I was not in any way, shape, or form paying attention to a single goddamn thing about this oath other than there was a billion boobs on screen, and I was thanking the movie for every single one of them.
It was pretty amazing. That was a lot. That was a lot of stuff going on there. A lot of stuff to take in, you know?
Yeah, I don't know if you could fit more boobs in a frame, but, you know, if you want to try, please do, movie makers, because this was incredible.
This was pretty amazing.
And the ritual that they do is silly and it's dumb, and it's very clearly an excuse to have them all get together naked, but I don't know about you, Matt, but I was pretty sure that every single one of the girls were giggling when they were doing this.
Yes, they were all.
They all looked like they were having a good time, and this was just super
everyone
fun
looked like they were just joking around, having fun.
And this sequence, and then the whole shooting the dude's mustache off, I'm like, I'm good, movie. You brought me back. I'm having fun.
Because the whole drug scene where they're taking it out, putting it in, again, it started to lose me. I was like, oh, this is just too much.
It was gross, but it was not nearly as bad because they were focusing in on business and what they were doing to like rip off the drug lord that they were running for.
Although one part, the guy slaps one of the girls. So it forcibly takes it out of her. It's just not good.
Yes, while that was brutal, it was definitely not nearly as horrible as the stuff that happened earlier. So I was kind of numb to it at that point, and I don't think that even registered for me. But yes, this sequence with the girls all swearing vengeance, it's that, and it also marks the point to where we don't have to watch them get nearly as brutalized as what we were before, because they do stand up for themselves a bit more.
Exactly. Yeah. Then things get a little bit better. Then we see the new boss and the guys and his guys. We see them loading up like a big vial of the drugs. So we now know that they are definitely the top guys of the drugs, and they have it. The middlemen, you know, they run the middlemen who are delivering it. But I do not believe they know that the middlemen are switching out for fake shit. So the girls all show up, get their cut of money, and the boss says they'll do one more run, and then they'll quiet down for a bit. Then Ochô shows up, and she says she wants in. And then we see girls go back to the middlemen, get their last shipments from the guys, and they tell the guys that the boss said this is going to be their last run. And so then we also go into, Ochô and the boss have sex, and he like goes down on her and does stuff, and she fakes an orgasm and says, you know, that was totally great. And he goes, yeah. And then she says underneath her breath, I was, you know, I'm acting, you idiot, you dummy. Cause you know, she's Ochô and he's a big blob of fucking disgustingness. So then
she is consensual to this, even though she's using it to manipulate him. So we get to see Reiko Ike naked again, and She seems like she's enjoying it and selling it, even though we know she's faking it, and at least we're hoping so because the guy's disgusting. And it turns out she is
faking it, and she's doing it for a purpose.
Yeah, she's manipulating him, and that's what's going on here. So she will use her body as a weapon if she has to.
Yep, and then she tickles him a lot, and he laughs, and his men are on the outside of like this wall, and they can see like kind of they see the shed their silhouettes, and he's laughing, and then his head comes through what's supposed to be like a comedic moment.
He's trying to escape her tickling him because they're having a little bit of play where she's in control tickling him, and he's barreling away from her, and his head pops through the door, and then he yells at the guys for snooping and listening in.
Yeah, exactly. And now we go into the final pretty much 25 minutes of the movie.
One of the nice things about these flicks, they're short, man. They're concise and they move.
An hour and 25 minutes in this movie. So, and this will get a little bit, what we're going to get into gets a little chatty though. So,
There's a lot to talk about still.
All right. So Tiger shows up and they have their meeting, and Tiger's making the new boss sign away his territory in a contract. Well, then she shows up. Ochô shows up, and she's like, "Nah, this bullshit. He doesn't even owe you this much." And she says, "Let's play the game." So they play the game. Ocho's beating the shit out of him, and he's like, "You're cheating, and you have to get naked to prove it." And she goes, "If I get naked and nothing's there, what happens?" And he goes, what do you want?" And she goes, "I want to start cutting off fingers." And he goes, "All right." Well, she gets naked, and as she whips her cloak off, she throws the card she was cheating with up on the ceiling so he couldn't see it. There she stands naked. He's like, "Shit." So then she takes a sword, starts cutting off fingers, and then the wife's like, "Hey, can you leave the middle finger?" And she makes a movement like, because that's, what he uses to get her off. She goes, "Woman to woman."
Yeah, woman to woman, can I ask a favor? Can you leave that middle finger? Like, that's the magic finger. Like, she doesn't care about the other ones. She could cut off more, and that's where Ochô decides to stop, right?
Yeah, and Ochô says, "Yeah, that's fine." And she goes, "You know what? Just to even things up," then the wife gets naked because she's like, "Hey, you had to be naked. I'll get naked."
Yeah. So she's bearing the humiliation as a way to
She cut off Tiger's fingers the way he did to the old boss. So
yeah, she did one and then the other, and then she was gonna go back. She did the ring finger, but then the wife begged her to leave the middle finger, and then Ochô stopped. It would have been funny if Ochô went and did the fucking trigger finger too.
Yeah. Right. What the hell. Oh, man. But yeah, again, good stuff. Good stuff. Okay. So then later on, after the sex, by the way, the boss also tells Ochô where the daughter is. Now, we can't hear it. He whispers it to her. Well, Ochô goes to Jyoji and says, "Hey, I know where the daughter is. Let's go get her." So we cut, and we see the new boss has her in a psych hospital. He attaches her to fucking electrodes and starts electrocuting her, and she bites off the finger of one of his men. So then the new boss just strangles the daughter to death, and you're like, fuck this guy. He's a piece of shit. So
this is the point of no return for these guys, where they've crossed a line and it's time for them to all die.
Yes, exactly. So
because technically the old boss's daughter is the one who should be in charge of the clan.
Yeah.
And they just basically murdered her this way instead of just keeping her out of the way.
Yeah, exactly. And then Ochô and Jyoji, they get in there to the building, and there's some comical stuff with some of the patients there with a guard. But it's almost, I don't even know why that's in there. It's just something they put in there.
I think it's just comic relief because a lot of the people who are supposed to be mental patients, I think they're really making them over the top and silly and dramatic for supposed to be humor, you know, like the same kind of style of mental patient you would see in a Cheech and Chong movie, basically.
Yeah. Something like that.
Pee Wee Herman talking about guys from Hamburger Trains and shit.
Yeah, pretty much. So, they find her body, and then the finger comes rolling out of her mouth. So then we go to her funeral, and Jyoji is praying at her funeral, and he looks up and he sees one of the henchmen is missing his finger, and that's when he knows, okay, the new boss did it. So it's time. I have my everything.
Yeah, the one thing that he was keeping from killing them all for is now gone.
Yeah, the only reason I'm keeping you alive, and you took it away. How fucking stupid are you?
Right.
So, that night, the new boss and Tiger show up, and new boss is giving Tiger some drugs. And he goes, "Hey, you're light." And he goes, "No, I'm not." And he brings in a lineup of ladies, and they both bring it out. And they bring out all the drugs, and they, you know, it comes out of them, and they have the right amount of drugs. So then he says, well, you know what we're going to do? Now that after this delivery, we're going to go ahead and kill all the girls who know about this, and then no one will be able to tell. And Tiger says, yeah, I got some grade A assassins here. Let's do it. Well, they start cornering the girls, and all these girls bring out weapons. They're still getting ready to corner her, and then the three middlemen show up, and they tell Tiger he's giving you fake drugs. So Tiger has his man test it, and yep, all that shit's fake. And then one of the middlemen looks at new boss and says, I hate the way you never should have been boss. I hate the way you're running the dock. It all sucks. So we're against you. And then all of a sudden, all the ladies from the thieves line up the entire area. Ochô pretty much tells the boss, hey, you know, I'm fucking done with you. You're going down. And Yoji's up there. And then, what was her name? Yushi, I believe. She tells the middlemen that she blames them for her friend's death, and she'll have her vengeance on them. So then the middlemen go, guess we have no excuse, and they say, team up to the old boss. The old boss says yes. Tiger says yes, and so they go, all right. So it begins the fight, and then they tell them, hey, show us your asses, as you're supposed to do. And so all the girls start getting naked.
Yeah, they say, they hurl some line, like some kind of an insult, and I'm like, you dumbasses, now you're just going to be even more distracted during the battle.
Well, and also, that first of all, that is dumb. Why would you do that?
Yeah.
But second of all, I thought the girls were taking off because it almost looked like then they got surrounded because you saw men on the outside of the windows, their silhouettes. So you knew, like, something was coming. And so then Ochô looks concerned because all the women got naked. But then she says, fuck it, let's go. And the fight begins. And this fight is fucking awesome. I can't really go step by step. I'm going to go by things that I thought were fucking just cool or super gross. All the girls threw fucking bombs down, like little pocket bombs down on the floor to cause mass confusion. Should say that before they started to attack.
And they also took out some dudes too with the shrapnel.
Yeah. Yes. And one of the guys, he's all fucking blown up. One of the girls has his claw glove on and fucking mauls his face with it. That's fucking cool. Just a ton of slicing and dicing naked chicks on other guys.
Hang on.
The main thing
to get from this sequence is, if you liked watching Reiko Ike slaughtering dudes while she was topless and blood splattering all over her, this sequence is like, well, if you liked that with one woman for you, would you say you'd like to see that with what, 20? Not enough, 30? 40. Is that 40 good?
50.
Look, I'm going to just jam pack the frame with so many naked women you won't even bother counting, and they're all going to get covered in blood from the carnage that they're throwing. Some of them will get injured too, and that will splatter blood on them, but mostly it's going to be from the dudes that they're wrecking. Would you enjoy that as much as you enjoyed the other thing? And to that I say, movie, yes, as a matter of fact, I fucking do. This is amazing. This sequence is so awesome, and yeah, we can't describe everything, but it's a huge finale. I wanted to back up just a little bit more, though, and the exchange that you're talking about, when it gets to this point, this final showdown, the movie just becomes like a yakety sax wacky comedy. Like, even the line deliveries are just like the guys like just throwing shit out is what it feels like. It just feels like the actors are just improvising, and then they get to the nude stripping, and then they get to the fighting. Like, it's so fucking wacky and just ultra late 60s, like, okay, we know what you're here for. Let's just give it to you. Like, the corniness of it. But it so fucking works, and it's super fucking entertaining.
Yeah, big time.
Like, to where when the guy says, you might as well just show us your asses if you're going to kill us, or whatever it is that he says, like, and demands that they get naked, and then they do. It's like, at that point, I'm like, yeah, that makes sense in this world after everything I've just seen.
Yeah, right? Well, and then one of the middlemen gets fucking, he's all beaten to shit, pretty much dying on the ground, and all the girls start pissing on him.
Uh-huh. And I was like, this is going to be something that Matt will probably have a problem with.
Well, I mean, I don't have a problem with it. He deserves all of that, if not more.
But like,
dude's a rapist.
Yeah, but that's like actual full-fledged water sports, dude. Like, I think those women are actually urinating on that actor.
Are they actually pissy? Okay, whoa.
I mean, Jesus. I didn't see a single tube anywhere. And
there were gross moments in this movie. There's one moment where like a guy was staring at a girl from underneath a bridge. She goes, hey, pervert, and like hawked a loogie on him.
Yeah, there are some gross out moments like that. But like, I really do feel like they are actually urinating on that dude as he's dying.
They might be. Jesus Christ.
Well, like, he's not actually dying, but as the actor's pretending to die, I think he's getting pissed all over. Yeah.
Yeah. Oof. Anyway, that was hardcore. So more and more men are killed. Ochô gets to Tiger and she kills him. The new boss is kind of all by himself now. He tries to kill Yoji, but he's out of bullets, so Yoji shoots him right in the head, then just like fucking throws things on him to kills him. All the girls are celebrating, and then we see Ochô walking off in the sunset with the ladies behind her. Roll credits.
It's important to note that the ladies are all naked when they're walking behind her, and they walk in a V shape, and it takes a while, but eventually you start seeing naked asses because it's all right? naked backs. And then like eventually you start seeing the line of ladies that are on their butts are out. And that's the way they roll the credits, is just ladies walking into the sunset naked. And I'm just like, thank you, movie. That's an awesome way to end this.
That's a great job, movie. You really did well here. The hard parts are really hard to watch. But the fun parts are really fun to watch. So
yeah,
the after movie this, dev giveth.
I feel like after this movie, we may have to put the brakes on covering more of the Japanese cinema. Cause it's not your bag. I just don't think it's for you.
Yeah. But I like part of it, but not all of it. I mean, there's some parts that are tough.
This is tame by comparison of other things I have seen.
Oh, well then, yeah, okay. Jesus.
Yep, that's the word you're looking
then
for.
Then we might have to tone it down. this sort of thing is not my bag, baby.
A lot of Austin Powers references out of you tonight.
Yeah, I know. I haven't even watched that movie in like forever, so I don't know where it's coming from. But
yeah, so the violence is pretty few and far between, but this ending sequence is very much like a laughing kind of thing, where like they're not even bothered with trying to have the pretense of any kind of like, you know, storyline at this point. It's just, hey, these are how these guys are going to die. This is this weird, crazy stuff. And it's like the ending orgy fuck scene in an old school porn, where like everybody that's in the cast just all gets together and like hashes it out at the very end.
Yeah, exactly.
Only with like violence and bloodshed, and like what I'm pretty sure is a bunch of ladies actually peeing on an actor when he's pretending to die.
That's just fucking weird. You never know though. Maybe that guy was into it.
I would assume that the actor is okay with it, because he didn't seem like he was, you know, I mean, other than he was pretending to die, it didn't seem like it was a real problem, if you catch my drift at a certain point.
Yeah. Yeah, right.
So like, I'm pretty sure if that's actually what's happening, and if that's not what's happening, then they really know how to make it look like 7 or 8 girls are peeing in unison.
They do. Yeah. I mean, you're right. That looked like some shit was going down there.
Well, some piss.
Yeah.
There's a lot of stuff in this movie where it's literally like, I have never seen that before. That's awesome. And that's, yeah, I've never seen that before. And I don't know if I ever want to see that again, in a couple of things here and there. But a lot of it is extremely enjoyable. And this is definitely not like any movie I'd ever see before in my life.
It was hardcore, man.
There's some crazy fun ass shit. And this is definitely not for everybody, but Female Yakuza Tale is for me. I will watch this again at some point.
I would too. As rough as some of those scenes were, the ones that, you know, won it, the ones that were good were just that good.
Yeah, this was such an interesting and fun flick, man. And I definitely, I gotta say, this is something that, like, you really have to know what you're about to get into.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, this is a pretty standard, like, most of the Yakuza movies that I have seen have this kind of content, and they just keep escalating from here. Like, if this was a rough thing for you to handle, you definitely should never watch Ichi the Killer, my man.
I've heard of that movie. And yeah, from all sounds of it, I probably should never watch that movie.
Because Ichi the Killer is like this flick on fucking crack.
Jesus Christ.
Like, for Yakuza movies, it's the craziest fucking Yakuza movie I think I've ever seen. And there's a bunch of stuff in this that like I had never seen before, but that doesn't mean that it was the unenjoyable stuff. Like, I've just never seen someone get their mustache shut off.
Yeah, right? I've never heard of that kind of shit before.
Now, I've seen a mustache become sentient and fly off of a dude's face to attack somebody else. That happens in John Dies at the end, but that's different, you know? This was a dude shooting off another dude's mustache in a display of force. That was amazing. And I'm just like, that's the hard thing I'm harping on. Like we talked about with the action sequences and the fighting, even the ending stuff, there's some sloppy stuff in the sequences where, like, you know, people are waiting to be told what to do before they do it. And the actual delivery of the weapons and the attack and some of the things definitely really don't look real. You can see like people like just move a sword just across the front of somebody like in camera, and we're supposed to believe that they're sliced, and yeah, it's not even facing that direction. So how did that cut actually happen? There's a lot of stuff in this that's like, you know, you kind of have to just go with and have fun because they're putting on a show where like it's at least 50 women, right? Like it's a huge cast of women that are naked in this at the end.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, like a huge cast of them.
They fill like three levels of a Patagonia and then just are running around, and there's just like nudity and boobs and blood everywhere and just like amazing shit.
Yeah.
There's a couple of sequences where I thought for sure that I saw the gates to heaven, like, you know, where the couple of ladies moving their legs around to like do some kicks and stuff. And I'm like, how did that get past the Japanese censors? And then I'm like, oh yeah.
Probably didn't care.
It wasn't enough to where you could actually see it. It was just in shadow. So I think it's fine, because that's the pixelation does that too.
Yeah.
You know, there's like a couple of parts where I thought I saw that, but maybe I'm just a fucking pervert because this was only like standard DVD resolution. But mostly it is an enjoyable film. The dark stuff gets really dark and it gets really brutal, and it didn't completely take me out of it, but like I just was like, I do not want to watch an entire movie of nothing but that.
Yeah, no, that if it was an entire movie of all that dark stuff, I don't know, I might have tapped out on you.
Which is like, all right, which is why I'm telling you shouldn't watch Ichi the Killer, my dude.
I will not. I usually take that when you say that to heart.
Yeah, I'm trying to help you here, my man.
yeah, right?
All right. Well, unless you got anything else to say, we made it a longer time in this movie than I was expecting us to.
Yeah, I know. Over an hour. I'm surprised by that kind of stuff, that we're even over an hour right now into the show. So
we had a longer intro with a lot of like talk and shop and everything. But yeah, like,
but still, I mean, I'm still surprised by all that. I didn't think we were going to go that far. But what saves it and makes you want to have to talk about it is the fact that that final scene, there's a lot to unpack.
Yeah, like I'm still trying to process it. The only other way that I can kind of describe it is like a Ken Russell film where it's just so much sensory overload, you can't even process everything you're seeing packed into that frame. But only with like Yakuza gunfights and swordplay and murder and death and blood everywhere. You know, like that's kind of like the level of the amount of nudity it is. It's like a huge Patagonia, and they're like the top three floors, and they're all naked.
Yeah.
And then they come down to fight, and I swear it's like this huge room. It just seems like there's more and more of them. And like, I can't remember seeing the same girl more than like two or three times. Like there was definitely different women doing all of these different sequences. So they had to go through and shoot them all individually to get little pieces like that, and it's edited together really well, and a lot of that stuff is just really interesting and fun. And like I said, it feels like a laugh in or like in a Benny Hill, like for no reason they all just start running around, and like that's the way that this sequence goes with like the choreography and the fighting. But like it's so fucking cornball and fun and filled with blood and violent and brutal that like none of that fucking matters. Like I think this will probably be the only thing that I will remember from the film, just like the Reiko Ike attacking all those dudes after jumping out of the bathtub starkers and just slaughtering them at the beginning of the other film.
True. True.
Like I will literally forget everything else and just be like, dude, you gotta see that scene in the Patagonia. And then like when the other stuff is happening and people are uncomfortable, you're like, yeah, I'm sorry about that, I forgot, but trust me, the Patagonia.
Yeah, trust it. Everything's going to be just fine.
I think that's the thing that we can take away from this movie, right?
Yeah.
All right, you got anything else, or are we going to go do the break now?
No. Well, we're good to go to the break.
Are you having trouble keeping up with the ebbs and flows of modern geekery? Is the real world holding you back from knowing what is happening in the geeky world? To answer these and other personal problems brought in by your friends, gaming group, and loved ones, Geek Radio Daily presents daily informational sessions brought to you by the wonderful Billy Flynn, the Flynnstress, and podcasting's Rich Siegfried. They contain such helpful segments as history, geek birthdays, box office results, the latest in DVD and Blu-ray, video game and comic releases. Why, they also have a weekly show hosted by the wonderful Billy Flynn and the Flynnstress, which includes interviews and commentary. And to make sure you are informed, Geek Radio Daily also provides you with your daily dose of geek news to make sure you know more than that jerk know-it-all Steve. Visit us at geekradiodaily.com. That's right, Geek Radio Daily. All the geek without the weight. Now available in fine Corinthian leather.
wrapped up in that. Oh, man. Oh. That was a fun fucking groove. And the whole time I'm like, damn, we fucking nailed it. That's exactly what this movie music reminds me of, is that James Bond, or that particular style that knocked off James Bond, like of like the in like Flint kind of movies that influenced Austin Powers. So
yeah,
that's exactly the kind of like musical score that we got in this, right?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, exactly.
So much fun. I really dig the music in the film. If nothing else, it really helped us get through some of the darker shit.
Hey, no shit, Jesus.
Speaking of helping us get through darker shit, give me some psyoppers.
Wow, that couldn't be a better intro for this new story. It comes from our buddy Robert.
Our man in the field.
Our man in the field,
our
Robert.
Our sole listener, no matter what we do.
No matter what we do. Man arrested at Kid Rock's bar for removing colostomy bag and swinging it around.
This is like traces of death fucked to porno.
You can't pay a bail? Well, I could probably fix that for a blowy.
Old cops are bumbling dummies.
We had a real shit storm at Kid Rock's last night, people. No, literally.
It's micro penis time.
Drop the humongous balls.
That's great. Good stuff, everyone. We're all doing well here.
I spilled pee all over the place, but I cleaned it up. I don't know what they got a problem with.
So, according to at Scan Nashville on Twitter, a call over Metro Nashville Police Radio last night for assistance at Kid Rock's Big Ass Honky Tonk Rock and Roll Steakhouse on Lower Broadway.
Every time you say that, I'm going to vomit. Jesus.
Yeah, right? That is like fucking, that is the dumbest name for anything ever. Seems there was a man who was stirring up shit at the bar. And by that, I mean he had removed his colostomy bag and was fleeing literal pool around at others.
It always comes back to dick.
According to the scanner traffic, this was the third time police had been in contact with the man that night, and he had previously refused medical attention both times. Is that the third time he'd been swinging around poop? Because I think after the first time, you should be arrested for that shit, right?
I think he was drunk and belligerent and just basically generally acting insane, and then somehow the police just let him be, and then this was the bridge too far. After this is like the arrestable offense that he had, I'm guessing.
I started doing drugs after that.
Yeah. So when police encountered the man again, he removed his colostomy bag and began filling in poo on the responding officers.
We're just trying to prolong the amount of time that happens before we watch this brother and sister fuck.
Yeah. Now, that's all this is.
It should be clarified that there's no indication whether this man was actually inside the bar or on the street in front of Kid Rock's. But you can imagine being out for a night party and a literal feces start raining down on you. There's just no coming back from that. Call it a night, call it a weekend, call it a year, but you gotta call it at that point. It's over. That's one time anyone could be thankful that they were still required to wear masks. Well, the poo-flinging man was eventually arrested. Thoughts and prayers for the poor police officer who had to transport him to the clink. And at least one officer was temporarily out of service ever having to run home to make a wardrobe change. Listen, if you got poop on you, I think you should get the rest of the night off. Just saying. I think you'd be like, all right. I don't have to come back to work. I got
to hell with the police.
Poo fling on you.
To hell with the police. To hell with the police. To hell with the police. To hell with the police.
All right. We get it. I'm not the biggest fan of the cops.
To hell with the police.
So, let's see here. But yeah, that sounds like that's the, all right. So, there is no word yet on what charges the man's facing. It's probably going to be assault. But
whoever wrote this article, Jesus Christ.
I don't know, man. Somebody wrote a joke article here, but it's a real thing, because I saw another article about this that was more of a real article. But, yeah. So,
this sounds like an article you would have written, like, the first night I met you.
Yeah, right? But he, that guy did fling shit around. That's about it. And he did, he flung shit. So he's arrested. They just don't know what they're charging him with yet, but poo ended up on people. Lots of poo.
That is, I mean, just thinking, I mean, I'd charge his ass with biological warfare.
I mean, you would think that could be done, like a terrorist act type shit.
It is throwing bodily fluids at someone. There is a specific assault charge that you get for that, but it's like assault with intent to effect or whatever else it is.
Yeah.
Because if an inmate spits at a guard, they can be charged with like attempted whatever, like they're infecting them with some kind of disease.
Isn't it now, like, if someone just spits on another person, that could be construed as assault? Like, if someone could be arrested for that?
I would believe so, because it's a bodily fluid, and that type of stuff that would get exchanged. So, I mean, breathing on people without a mask knowingly is like, a chargeable offense at this point right now.
And it should be.
Right. And throwing your poo, it's going to spread whatever other kinds of diseases you have. Definitely that's coming out in your feces. No, but seriously, man, like, you get someone shit on you, you're going to get infected with something that they have. That's something that happens, you know?
Agreed.
Plumbers need to be weary of that kind of stuff. And guys that are working in fucking sewer mains need to be weary of that kind of stuff. That does happen.
I think they are, most of them. I mean, if they're any good,
they can get vaccines and shots for like hepatitis and a bunch of other fucking things that you catch. Like, you have to have that kind of stuff when you work with those things. So yes, him throwing his feces at people should be an extremely offensive charge. Like, he should have a very higher degree, because that is fucking foul. And you could really, like, if he has something that is communicable, that is severely deadly, and it,
oh my God, you get someone sick, and if they die, then you should be charged for murder.
You absolutely should be, because it's the same thing if you're just wantonly throwing bullets around at people and you kill one, that's still murder.
Yeah. If you cough on someone because you think you're so fucking funny and fucking an edgelord, and they get COVID and die, you should get arrested and put in jail for the rest of your fucking life.
We're standing on a soapbox. Let's do another story.
Yeah, it's really high. The air is getting thin up here.
Let's do another story.
All right. I can do that. So, let's see here. This is posted by the Cinema PsyOps. But probably you. It's supposed to be you. Let's see here. Northumberland Longridge Towers school trip to strip club, school strip club teacher banned. That's the most fucking disjointed fucking headline I've ever read.
I did not post that. Someone else posted that in the group. I think you're reading the top of it because that's the group, and then the person's name should be right underneath it.
Oh, I'm sorry. It is. This is Robert again.
Our man in the field. Always bringing us the stuff. Our man in the field,
Robert, with a whole nother one. Let me re-hit this headline. Northumberland, Lone Ridge Towers, school, strip club, teacher, band. That's the literal, that's a hard fucking article here. An IT teacher who threatened pupils and took some to a strip club while he was drunk during a school trip has been banned from teaching for 3 years.
Okay.
Richard Glenn's.
Well, hang on. Right. The article title, first of all, right off the bat, sounds like lyrics from a shoegazing band. It's like a bunch of things that shouldn't have something to do with each other. And when you read them off, they just kind of all go together. I'm just saying.
And let's see, Richard Glenn's behavior was so unacceptable, he was sent home early during a Lone Ridge Tower School's trip to Costa Rica in July 2019. And then I lose my place. 2019, the teaching regulation agency heard. Mr. Glenn, 55, admitted gross misconduct and was dismissed in August 2019. Northumberland, I'm sorry, private school costs up to $4,850. Whatever their monies is, a term for a day pupil. A misconduct panel heard Mr. Glenn, who taught computer science and had been head of sixth form since 2007 and was one of the leaders of the group of 16 to 18-year-olds that went to Costa Rica on July 5th, 2019.
I got nothing for any of this, my man.
Yeah, this is pretty bad shit here. He was supposed to be there until the July 28th, but after 6 days, he was sent home by the expedition's leader due to this behavior. His actions include drinking with pupils, allowing one or more pupils to drink alcohol despite being under the legal age of 18, threatening to kick the head in of one pupil and kill another, telling one pupil, quote, I'm not in trouble, you'll be in trouble, end quote. After being aggressive to one pupil, he kissed the boy's forehead and told him, you're all right. Taking one or more pupils to a strip club, acted aggressively towards the woman leading the trip when she tried to help him back to his tent, and exposing himself to the woman in a shared hotel room, although it was agreed this was not malicious or sexually motivated. So probably he was wandering around drunk, didn't realize he didn't have his pants on.
Possibly.
The panel, Yes. The panel said his behavior would place one or more pupils in his care at risk. It added that there was no malice or sexual intent in taking the students to the lap dancing club, but Mr. Glenn admitted it was inappropriate and unprofessional for him to fail to control the situation. He added he could not remember what happened due to a state of intoxication, but he did not dispute the recollection of those present, the report said. The panel was shown photos of drink tickets bought at the strip club and said it was satisfied that his conduct amounted to misconduct of a serious nature, which fell significantly short of the standards expected of the profession.
Wait, what did he do that was so wrong?
Do I have to go through that fucking list again? Are you fucking kidding me, man? You know how hard it was to get through all that?
Not that I was going to read it again. Like, I was just trying to pretend like I didn't think he did anything wrong. And then, like,
I got you. I'm like, did you actually forget?
It'd be awesome if I did forget. That'd be even better because I could make you read it again. Shit, I fucked that up. I thought like I was trying to play it to where I was gonna shock
like,
you.
What is he doing wrong? The way you said it made it sound like you just forgot, not that you're being indignant.
Okay then, Matt, what is it exactly he did wrong?
Yeah, that's more like, what are you gonna even do nothing? What is he doing?
Okay, continue.
All right. The panel's report said Mr. Glenn was, at various times during the school trip, under the influence of alcohol and therefore not in a position to adequately take decisions or act in loco parentis should the need arise. This was in circumstances where pupils under his care were in an unfamiliar country, far from home, and relying on him for guidance and protection. Mr. Glenn was an experienced teacher and pastoral leader who would have been expected to lead an overseas trip safely and would have been well aware of the conduct expected of him. After the 3 years have elapsed, Mr. Glenn will need to apply for the ban to be lifted, the panel said. So, that guy fucked up something serious.
Well, that litany list of things that he did are like, are ridiculous. Like, any one of those things should be actionable in a court of law, but he got away with it because it was in another country and there's not really much they can do about it.
Nope. As long as they're spending money.
You did say Costa Rica, right?
Yes, Costa Rica. The drinking age legally was 18 there, so it doesn't fall under our federal laws.
Yeah, except a couple of them were under 18, so...
Yeah, but yeah, so that he got in trouble with. Yeah.
This guy's gotta have, like, some kind of repercussion beyond just not being able to teach for 3 years, right? Like, there should be some legality involved in some of this.
I don't think so. I think, well, so far that's all I read. Is that. I don't think there's not saying anything else is going to happen. But who knows? Maybe you have to wait for those lawsuits to now start.
Maybe. Or either that
get
or
get done with the dismissal first and then get to the other stuff.
Either that or this motherfucker has Saul Goodman as a lawyer and that's how he's staying out of jail. Because Jesus. Oof. It sounds like a list of things that you want in a best friend in college.
Yeah, right? not in the guy teaching your kids.
Exactly. Fuck. It's definitely a list of things you don't want to have your kids go through in college.
Yeah, right? Jesus Christ.
You fear that day, even though it's so close.
Fuck yeah, for me it is.
I know, that's what I'm saying. You, specifically, Matt. I almost said your real last name.
Oh, goddamn.
Fear that day when your kid goes to college, because you know what you were like when you went there.
Oh, fuck. Yeah, I do. Shit.
And that's the note I want to end this show on.
Thanks a lot, buddy.
If you enjoyed this show, then make sure you check out the other great shows on the Legion Podcast Network, like Cinema PsyOps, Cinema Beef, Devour the Podcast, Duncan and Bo Come Correct, Exploding Heads Horror Movie Podcast, Friday the 13th, Get Slayed, The Helming Power Hour, Hello, This is the Doom Show, Hero Ghost Show, Kill the Cast, Underwater Kaiju from Outer Space, Jerry Hates Action, Legion After Dark, Mental Health, Obsessive Cinema, Discourse, Pick Six Movies, The Podcast by the Cemetery, The Podcast on Haunted Hill, The Psychosemantic Podcast, Rick Radio, House of Wax, Dude Looks Like the 80s, Rabbit and Red Radio, The Shadecast, Short Bus Cinema, Two Drink Minimum Commentaries, The VD Clinic, Who Will Survive Horror Podcast, and Witch vs. the Doomsday Clock. With such a wide spread of shows, there is guaranteed to be a niche for you to fall in love with. horror, politics, movies, books, sex, music, commentaries, health, video games, kaiju, action, news, comedy, and opinions that would most likely get you killed in some parts of the world, we are proud to bring you some of the best podcasting in the world. Check us out at www.legionpodcast.com, iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, YouTube, and any other dark corner of the internet where podcasts can be found.
That one for real. Like, I usually like just let it play, and I was like, I was
grooving to it.
Yeah, man, that fucking fuzz wall with the phaser mixed in, that was super cool on that fucking guitar doing the solo over that. That was fucking sweet.
It was good stuff.
Yeah, so this is gonna play well. I'm doing all of this talking. We're gonna have the sort of medley of music that I have, but like right as we close the show is when I'm gonna kick in with Miss Reiko Ike herself actually singing. That's how we're gonna close out this show whenever I'm done with this show housekeeping horse shit that I always gotta do.
Oh, okay. All right. Cool. Tight.
So what I'm thinking is we stop fucking around, right? And I just fucking read the shit and then we call it quits, right? Like, nobody wants to have fun with us, right? Like, they want to hear
no
that.
No one should ever want to have fun with us.
Well, if they wanted to have fun with us, what I would suggest is that they go back and listen to all of our previous 298 episodes that are available for them at legionpodcast.com/cinema-psyops. They're all still there. I checked.
They're all there. We're very happy that they're all there.
If you'd like to interact with us at Facebook, probably the best place to really kind of interact with me is directly with me. I'm Court Psyops. You can try and interact with Matt there. He's only there when we record, and so you shouldn't be interacting with him then, but he still does it and somehow keeps doing the notes. So he's Matt Psyop there, and I am Court Psyops there. We also have our Facebook group. That's where you're going to find the memes. We post them there. Our friends post them there.
All the great memes.
Some bots post them there that I don't even know who they fucking are, I guess.
Yeah,
maybe they're
let
a person.
Bots post.
Sometimes I repost the stuff from our Instagram feed of cinema_psyops. They're in the Cinema Psyops group. Now, we also have email available for both Matt and myself. You can email feedback to Matt, psyopmatt@gmail.com. You can email feedback to Court, cinemapsyopscourt@gmail.com. I'm also available on Twitter, and so is Matt. He is at psyopmatt there, and I am at court_psyop. So, I think we finally arrived at the part that the people really wanted to hear. Is that right, Matt?
I think so.
Okay, well, that's where I sink my hook in. Look, everybody, next week is 300 fucking episodes. For Christ's sakes, show a little love and send us an M4A, an MP3, some kind of an audio file you can record on your phone, just wishing us a happy 300 and letting us know that you still fucking love us. Please. And
yeah,
emails too. I'll take emails too at cinemapsyopscourt@gmail.com. Just, you know, kind of keep them short because I don't need a long fucking letter. Just let us know that you're happy that we made it for 300 episodes, okay?
Yeah. Come on, love us. The only love we get.
And like Miss Reiko Ike, who kicks the fuck out of everything that's around her, kick the fuck out of this week and make it your bitch. Who's
さは人飽き人一緒の夢が寂しい女道どこで生きようとイノシカオチョついてくるやつはついてくるやつは影ばかり
Hello, hello.
What up?
What up?
Let's not waste the fact that we're starting somewhat fucking early. Start recording on your side.
All right. I am recording on my side. Maybe. Now I am. One, two, three.
That was very indecisive of you.
Yes. Well, sometimes I don't know if I'm recording or not. Because the machine takes a while.
You don't see the waveform right off the bat?
No. Usually I do. This time it like just had to think a little bit after I hit it. And then it started going.
I am getting some really weird noise off of you.
Really? Hold on. I think I know one thing. I've got to change chairs.
All right. Talk again for me.
All right. I'm back with the right chair.
Did you talk at all?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
I can now. Talk again. I want to try a setting real quick, okay?
I'm here. Just talking.
You're supposed to be talking.
Yeah. I'm talking right now. Totally talking.
Yeah. I don't hear you at all. Yeah. That's weird.
You don't hear me?
Yeah, I wasn't hearing you at all when I tried to cut out just the noise part of it, like just to filter that noise, but it dropped you out for some reason. Great, that means the noise must be coming somewhere from the inside of the system.
It's coming from inside the house!
Something, yeah. what the fuck is that? All right, I'm going to try something rather drastic. Give me 2 seconds.
Not a problem.
All right, I want you to talk now, and let's see if I still get that noise.
Hello, how are you? I'm okay. All right. Everyone's okay. Yay, aren't we happy?
All right, fine. I'll just isolate it later. Yeah, I got a 60 hertz buzz, so something's causing that. God fucking damn it. Just when I had to go back, I was going to go back and replace all of these caps. Eventually. Now it's coming up even sooner that I have to do and fix this fucking shit. All right, whatever. Yeah. Let's do the show. So female Yakuza right. Tail work for you just fine?
Yes, female. Yes, work perfectly.
Awesome. All right, let's rock and roll.
All right.
You are really, really stepping over a whole lot of stuff that happened, though, here, dude.
No, she literally just says, you've got the wrong person. That's how it started for me.
Yeah, so she gets pointed out by a lady on the docks, then a rickshaw guy picks her up.
No. This is the very beginning. This is before the intro.
Oh, all right.
Did you miss that?
No, I didn't miss that. I get what you're saying. I just forgot about it. Okay, so this is the fight sequence.
I can't
sequence.
Believe you forgot about that. Yeah, I wrote it down.
This is the fight sequence for the credits. Go right ahead.
Yeah. Right before the credits.
I'll excise my stupid ass and put it into the outtake so people can laugh at me for the 299th time there. Can make it your bitch. All right, we're up.
All right.
I was like, I have no way to bring it back. Let's try this. And I was like, I was going to play that song, so that works.
Let's just see what we got.
You still rolling?
I'm getting ready to stop right now.